The M4 Sherman needs no introduction. Emblematic of America's arsenal of democracy, nearly 50,000 of them were produced, and the chassis became the base for a dozen different vehicles, from tank destroyers and self-propelled guns to recovery vehicles and artillery tractors. They even made it swim. But today, we're looking at the Sherman's origin story, the first of its kind. Today, we cover medium tank T6. Welcome to another Tank Encyclopedia voiced article. I'm your host, Daniel, and today I will be covering the T6 medium tank, the pilot model of the iconic M4 Sherman. If you like what we do and want to see more of it, don't forget to like the video, and if you haven't already, subscribe so you don't miss a single upload. Our story begins at the very end of August 1940. The M3 Lee had not even left the drawing boards, and already members of the US Armored Force were looking at its replacement. The biggest issue with the M3 is that the main 75mm gun was mounted in the hull, rather than in a rotating turret. So the designing of a turret that could fit a 75mm gun was made a priority. In addition, the replacement design needed to be shorter. At over 10 foot, 3 meters tall, the M3 stuck out like a sore thumb compared to most other contemporary designs. It was not until the start of February 1941 that the design team could begin work on the new tank. By mid-April, some of the major features were being set out. The new tank would carry over the lower hull of the earlier M2 medium tank, including tracks, engine, and gearbox. For ease of transportation, the lower hull of the M2 had been designed to fit on a standard gauge railway flat car. The upper hull was to share as many existing components with the M3 as possible, and could be either welded or cast. Armour thickness was at most 3 inches, or 76.2mm. The twin driver-operated 30 cal machine guns mounted in the hulls of the early model Lees also made an appearance here, alongside a third 30 cal to be operated by the tank's co-driver. The crew had 2 hatches on the top of the vehicle, one each in the turret and upper hull, alongside an escape hatch on both sides of the hull to evacuate away from incoming fire, as well as a single floor escape hatch. Both driver and co-driver had a single vision slit with armoured cover, the co-driver also having a sight rotor mounted in the upper hull for his 30 cal, while the driver had an observation periscope for use while driving buttoned up. 2 radios were also included within the vehicle, an SCR-508 set in the turret, operated by the commander, and an SCR-506 within the hull, operated by the co-driver. The 506 also featured an antenna, the base of which was protected by an armoured cover. This was soon done away with, however, owing to the fact that the antenna got bent every time the gunner tried to turn the turret to the right. Aware that the vehicle was likely to see use in British service as part of Lend-Lease, the radio brackets could also accept the British No. 9 radio set. The turret was also designed with a removable plate, allowing for the possible fitting of various armaments. This included a single American 75mm or British 57mm 6-pounder gun, a 105mm howitzer, twin 37mm guns, or a 57mm gun with a 37mm coax. An anti-aircraft variant was also designed, equipped with 3 50 cal machine guns. From the M3, a new design with a reduced crew size of 5, with a driver and co-driver sitting within the hull, and a commander, gunner and loader in the turret. The basic turret layout, with the gunner sitting to the right of the gun and the loader to the left, with the commander sitting behind the gunner, has remained virtually unchanged throughout US tank design since. What hasn't gone unchanged, however, is the internet. Protect your data with our sponsor, Atlas VPN. Atlas is a VPN, or virtual private network, that encrypts your data and hides your virtual location across all your devices. Right now, Atlas VPN is running a huge discount. If you click on our special link in the description, you can get access to Atlas VPN for 82% off. If you have ever found yourself involved in a heated argument on a World of Tanks forum, Atlas VPN has you covered, as it hides your IP address so your online activities stay covert. Atlas VPN also has a data breach monitoring. This means that you will be informed of any data breaches that have leaked your personal information, such as your password, email address, or social security number. And the best part is that our special link in the description can get you access to Atlas VPN special deal for a whopping 82% off. Time is running out, so get it now. In May of 1941, the Ordnance Committee recommended the construction of a full-sized wooden mock-up and a single pilot tank, approval for which was granted in June, with the design now receiving the designation Medium Tank T6. The pilot vehicle was a cast hull design, constructed by the General Steel Castings Corporation. Only the turret and upper hull needed to be constructed, however, the lower hull and suspension being borrowed from an M3. At the same time, a second vehicle of welder construction was apparently being built by Rock Island Arsenal, although a number of modifications to reduce the number of plates and welded joints needed resulted in delays in its construction. When, or if, the welded pilot model was completed is unknown, as no photographs are known to exist, save for one showing a scale model design of the vehicle. Although, curiously, the model displays a number of modifications that were only set out several months later. The initial pilot vehicle was completed in early September 1941. Although the T6 was designed to mount the 75mm M3 main gun, as built, the tank was equipped with the earlier and shorter M2 variant. The M2 was breech-heavy compared to the M3, and thus the gyro-stabilizer did not work correctly at first, requiring the installation of a counterweight. After only a day of observations by members of both the Armoured Force and Ordnance Committees, a number of changes to the design were suggested. This included the removal of the sponson escape hatches, which compromised armour integrity and restricted the number of rounds carried in the sponson racks, and the replacement of the distinctive M3 cupola with a split hatch design that would become standard on the M4. There was also the addition of a pintle-mounted 50 cal machine gun for anti-air protection, as well as a gun shield to protect the main gun from splash damage. The sight rotor for the bow machine gun was also removed, and an additional hatch was added for the co-driver. At the same time as the T6 was undergoing development, a similar design was taking shape a bit further north. The Canadians, also using the M3's lower hull as a base, produced the cruiser tank Ram. The pilot vehicle arrived at the Aberdeen Proving Grounds in August 1941, where it was found to be unsuitable for American service due to the smaller turret ring of 60 inches, compared to the 69 of the T6, permitting nothing larger than the British 6-pounder to be fitted in the turret. And even then, the turret was described as being cramped. The British likewise found the tank unsuitable for service, and the vehicle was relegated to training duties, although the hull did find success as the base for the Sexton self-propelled gun and the Ram Kangaroo armoured personnel carrier. On the 11th of December 1941, the T6 was accepted into service, the welded hull design receiving the designation Medium Tank M4, whilst the cast hull design became the M4A1. Production of the M4 began in earnest in February 1942, about a year after the design process had begun. The rest, as they say, is history. The fate of the T6 pilot model is less certain. It appears to have been kept stateside for tests and modification work, as the last picture of it shows the tank with additional armor plates added to protect the differential housing. It may have been scrapped during the Korean War era scrap drives, although there remains a small hope that the tank sits forgotten somewhere, awaiting restoration. This concludes our look at the Medium Tank T6. If you aren't already, consider becoming a subscriber so you don't miss a single video. If you want to contribute more directly, consider donating on Patreon or PayPal. The money comes back to you in the form of bigger and better videos. Until next time, keep us in your sights.